kinds of headings, you know, in the news are really helpful for us as practitioners. I think what happens to us is that we do start to kind of buy into some of these scary images, and when we're scared, I think we can't respond well to our clients. The worst thing really is that it buys into this terrible stereotype that is really, really unhelpful, that misses completely the personal nature of drug use, and particularly meth use, and that's what hopefully we're going to be talking about today. So what I want to do is to really think through how we, this is for my son who's a very big Star Wars fan. What I want to do today is to kind of think through that hype and cut through that and think a little bit more about what we know about meth users, and I'm particularly going to be talking about some of the more recent brain science that's emerged, and I want to try and connect that science to practice a little bit. And then I'm really also looking forward to the talks by ReGen, who have started to put some of that science into practice in various ways. I think the first thing to start with is to remember that we didn't always have this view about amphetamines. This is it's called a benzodrine inhaler. Benzodrine's a brand name for amphetamines in the 1940s. It's, I think it was just used as a Ventolin inhaler. You know, took the cap off and take a bit of a suck at it. And by the end of the 40s, in 1948, there was about 10 million of them sold in the US alone. So they were absolutely everywhere. And then what happened was that we started to see problems with them. People were dismantling them and kind of taking them straight and putting them in their coffee. And people were starting to get dependent on them. So the government said, right, that's it. We're getting rid of those now. But then what's happened is that we've got a huge illicit market that's developed instead. So unintended consequences of making these drugs more difficult to obtain. This is how easy they were to obtain. I just want to show you this because I love these things. I've got thousands of them, but I'll just show you a couple. You can see I've highlighted where the benzodrine inhaler is. This is from Pan Am. It's a service trolley menu. And you can just pick them up on the trolley. The funniest thing, I think, is that it's free. Like, you, on the side here, the alcohol is you have to pay for, but the amphetamine is free. And this one is methamphetamine. Syndrox is a brand name for methamphetamine. It's a little hard to see, but this woman's pregnant, and it was marketed to reduce weight gain during pregnancy. So it was absolutely everywhere. Now, what we're talking about is a range of drugs that we label amphetamines that are made up of different types, different chemical structures, but exclusively in Australia, just about exclusively in Australia, the street amphetamine is methamphetamine, aside from a little bit of diverted other things, dexamphetamine and other pharmaceuticals. And I won't go into this too much because I think you know all of this stuff, but there's kind of three types. There's powder and pills, there's base, which we don't see as much as we used to, and there's ice, of course, the infamous ice. And you can see from these figures that these are among meth users, how many people use the different types, and you can see that still by far the majority are using speed powder. And about 50% of people say that they use ice either occasionally or regularly. But when we're talking about, in Victoria at least, this isn't reflected in every state, but in Victoria you can see from these figures that the middle line is ice, and you can see that it's been less than speed for a long time and now has started to overtake speed. So most of our illicit drug users are now using ice rather than the powder, whereas previously they mostly were using powder. Now, meth users come from right across society, but there are a couple of groups that do use more than the average. So youngish people between 20 and 29. Under 20, very few people use, but once you hit kind of 19, 20, then people start to experiment with it. men who have sex with men and gay men, people who go to dance parties and clubs, and a number of occupational groups. So particularly sex workers, construction and mining, media and communications and finance, and hospitality have a much higher rate of use than the general population. General population is about 2.5%, we'll say, that they've used in the last year. These groups, somewhere between 4 and 6%. Young people, about 6%. Are using 6.5%. So it's quite a lot more in these groups. And of course, illicit drug users are big users of methamphetamine. Around 70 to 80% of illicit drug users say that they use meth, regardless of whether that's their drug of choice or not. So why am I telling you all this? Because I want us to think a little bit about the different types of meth users that we might come across. And at one end, there's the occasional, what I've called occasional users, but they might be, you know, reasonably regular users who are probably using powder or pills, so they're using what we refer to as speed. They're probably not dependent. Around 15% of them will kind of move on to become dependent at some point, but they're probably just using recreationally at the minute. They're probably swallowing, snorting. They're generally in paid employment. And they tend to be in that 20 to 29-year-old age bracket. But they do come with some mental health symptoms and sleep problems and a range of other things that I will talk about a bit more in a minute. So this group is the kind of group that might show up to their GP or to community health or to some other health professional reporting problems with depression, feeling flat, anxiety, not being able to sleep well, but they might not necessarily disclose that they're using meth. And today I'm not that interested in that group because there are a lot of guidelines, let me just show you how many there are, that will help you respond to this group if you're working in one of those sectors. So these are actually just the ones that I've been involved in writing, and there's hundreds of others all over the place. But these are particularly, they're the most recent and they're quite good. I'd say they're good because I wrote them. But this one's called Treatment Approaches for Users of Methamphetamine, and this one's dealing with challenging situations, so aggression and psychotic kind of symptoms. But so I'm just going to leave that group for a minute, but we're going to concentrate more on this, what I've called regular users, or we might call them dependent users. This group are much more likely to be using crystal meth. They're much more likely to be dependent. They're probably smoking or injecting their drugs rather than snorting or swallowing. And they come to us with significant mental health problems and with sleep issues, nutrition issues, and fairly significant brain changes, which is what we are going to talk about primarily today. So some of these brain changes, the reason why I wanted to talk about these brain changes particularly and try and connect those to treatment is because meth, unlike any other drug, has a very, very powerful effect on the brain, and it has a very, very long-term effect on the brain, and this has a direct impact on how people present into treatment. So let me just, let me get my brain up. Okay, so the main action of methamphetamine is through the dopamine system. And some of you will have heard this before because it's very fashionable at the moment, this brain science stuff. You can see that these kind of lines here, they are the dopamine pathways, and you can see that the main action of dopamine is through the frontal area, particularly the prefrontal cortex, and the frontal lobe is responsible for thinking, planning, decision making, all the higher order processes that we need to function every day. And the other big area is the limbic system, which controls and regulates our emotions and our social interactions. And so those two areas, particularly, they need to work together in order for us to function well during the day. Now, I have a brain. I really wanted a real one, but that would have been too gross. So this frontal area here, the whole frontal lobe is this kind of area, but the prefrontal cortex is around here that has all the dopamine receptors and is responsible for thinking. The inside here is where the limbic system is, and they kind of chat to each other all the time. So what might happen is the limbic system might throw up an emotion or a memory triggered by something in our environment, and it sends it to the frontal lobe, and the prefrontal cortex decides what to do with it. So, for example, someone might be yelling at you, screaming at you, and you're getting an emotional reaction to it, and the frontal lobe says, well, they're just having a bad day, let's just walk away quietly and leave them to it. Okay. Whereas the limbic system saying, come on, let's go, this is really horrible, let's get up, get them. So they're kind of talking to each other and settling down. So when your dopamine system is disrupted in both of those centres, then those two centres can't talk to each other. They can't function on their own and they can't talk to each other. I should have just said before as well that I'm not a neuropsychologist. I'm a psychologist that works with clinical populations. So this is the Nicole Lee version of brain science. It's very, very simplified, and I do apologise if there's any neuroscientists in the audience because they'll be kind of rolling their eyes at me at this point. So if we look a bit closer into the dopamine system, what happens actually in the brain, we've got these little blue things that are, this is not what dopamine looks like, but just a representation. Anytime something nice happens to us, we get this little squirt of dopamine that comes through the transporters into the receptors and it goes bing, feel good. And then they move back into the transporters and they get taken up again to be reused again the next time something nice happens to us. And so this system works beautifully until we take meth, and then it releases loads and loads and loads. Some of the estimates are 1,200% of normal baseline levels. And what also happens is that you could see that the methamphetamine molecules, they're the yellow ones, stick into the transporters and stop the reuptake. So it can't be recycled and reused. So we've just got loads and loads of dopamine feeling great, but at the same time, it's wearing out the dopamine system and we don't have any dopamine left after a period of time. So what happens is that we feel great for a really long, long time, hours and hours and hours, which is unnatural. And at 1,200% of how we normally feel. But then after that, there's no dopamine to make us feel okay. So we're flat, depressed, unmotivated, can't do anything. And this happens to regular users and occasional users as well. The difference is that with occasional users, we can have a rest and the dopamine system kind of regenerates on its own and it's all good. But after a while, if you keep doing this to your brain, then there's no recovery, the recovery's much longer. So we know that high levels of dopamine are linked to psychosis. Not really sure how that works, but so when you have loads of amphetamines on board, releasing all this dopamine, that's when you get the kind of psychotic symptoms. Some people then go on to, it may be a trigger for an organic schizophrenia or whatever, but most people recover when they stop using. But at the other end, when the dopamine runs out and you wear out your system, the brain is looking for more dopamine. So the brain's kind of searching and searching, and the best place to get more dopamine is to use meth again. So we get lots of craving and a high risk of relapse as well. The other things that happen is that because dopamine regulates thinking processes and motivation and reward systems, it makes it really hard to concentrate, to pay attention, to activate those higher order thinking processes and for those thinking processes and the emotional centres to talk to each other. So people start to feel, as I said, flat, depressed, some of the things that are opposite to taking meth. The other two systems that are kind of important, there's loads of systems involved when you take meth, but these two are also important for what we're going to talk about in a minute, is the noradrenaline and the serotonin system. So noradrenaline is the brain chemical that activates the fight or flight response. So when that's overstimulated, you can kind of start to see why people are aggressive or angry or suspicious, because they're like on. The serotonin system regulates mood, specifically optimism, which I find interesting. So, you know, whether you find things positive or not. Ecstasy releases lots of serotonin, which is why everybody's so loved up when they're on ecstasy. Everyone's fantastic and I love everybody and everything's beautiful because of this optimism kind of trigger. So what happens is when these systems wear out too, you're starting to get kind of similar effects. So you've got these dopamine effects, you've got noradrenaline effects, and you've got serotonin effects all kind of working together to create some of these symptoms. So you can you start to see how this, what's happening in the brain might act out behaviourally? Feeling flat, can't really do anything, have trouble initiating stuff. So just as a summary, I guess, what we've got is then a bunch of, sorry, I went a bit overboard with the transitions. So we've got a bunch of cognitive deficits that are quite significant because of the powerful effects of meth on the brain. Including some higher order functioning, the memory functioning, and some emotional functioning. But what does that mean for us in a treatment setting, I think, is the more important thing. One of the things, for example, is maybe having trouble getting to appointments. Have you noticed that meth users are incredibly unreliable in getting to appointments? Not because they don't want to be there. I can tell you it's not because they don't want to be there. It's because these functions in the brain have been affected. Their planning ability and their memory has been affected. Now, when we go to an appointment, we make a doctor's appointment, it's kind of seamless. Our brains are working okay, so we know the time, we know how to get there, we just go, and it just seems straightforward. But when you think about what's required required to get to an appointment, you have to remember that you've got the appointment to start with. So if your memory is affected, that's hard. Even if you've got it written in a diary, you've got to remember to check your diary to see what time it is. You've got to figure out what time you need to leave to get there in enough time to make your appointment. You've got to factor in contingencies. You've got to work out how you're going to get there. Are you going to ride your bike, or are you going to catch public transport, or are you going to drive? You need to figure out, if you drive, how far away you're going to be able to park. So there's all these steps that just kind of happen when your brain's functioning normally, but are completely disrupted when your brain is showing these deficits that we see with meth users. So it just makes a simple task like getting to an appointment incredibly difficult. Some other things that we might have trouble with, that meth users have trouble with, are things like completing tasks, because that requires a fair amount of focus and quite a bit of planning. Taking on new information, because that requires you to attend to things in a careful way and remember them. Thinking about the consequences of actions, goal setting, but particularly working towards a goal, because the same level of planning that's required to get to an appointment is required, probably more, to get to a goal that you've set, an abstract goal that you've set for yourself. It's difficult to stop inappropriate behaviour because the emotion systems are unregulated. It's really hard to switch from one topic to another because flexibility of thinking's been disrupted, and that's another higher order activity. And there may be unexpected outbursts of emotion because the frontal lobe's not taking control of the emotional centres anymore. It's kind of, they're all separated out. So can you start to see how things might be quite difficult for someone whose brain's impaired from having meth on board or from the effects of meth? Let me just tell you about a client that I had. I don't see him anymore. He relapsed. He wasn't one of my successes. But he did very well for about a year in treatment. He was a young man in his late 20s. Very, very bright. He was an engineer, and he'd moved into this kind of, from this technical role into a sales role. And he wasn't selling little things. He was selling like multi-million dollar equipment to big engineering companies. And they needed his technical expertise for this sales. But he had some social anxiety. So he started taking meth to go to these meetings. And for the first 18 months, he was absolutely on fire. He was their best salesperson. He was, everybody loved him. He was all over it. And then he started to see some of these cognitive deficits. And by the time he got to me, he went through a home withdrawal on Christmas Eve, of course. And then when he came back to see me for counselling, he had lots and lots of trouble keeping his appointment, getting to work, thinking about what he had to do during the day, actually planning his daily schedule and actually getting anything done. So he would do things like he'd have to go to work, he'd get up at 7, 8 o'clock, still a reasonable time to actually have enough time to get to work. He was only like 20 minutes bike ride from where he had to be. And he would, so one day he said to me, he went to get on his bike to ride, and it needed some repair. So his thinking processes weren't flexible enough because of the meth to actually say, well, my bike's not working, I'll take this other bike that's sitting here that is working, or I'll catch the bus, or I'll walk. He's fixated on this idea that he needs to take this bike, and so therefore I need to fix it first before I take it. So he's made a plan, and he's not flexible enough to switch that plan when the circumstances change. So he's fixing his bike, only takes 10 minutes to actually fix the thing that needed to be fixed. I had no idea about bikes, so I don't know what it was that he needed to fix. But he said, oh, it would have only taken me 10 minutes, except he needed a part. So he had to go into the garage, he had to look for the part, he got a little bit distracted because his attention and his concentration's not very good. He started doing other things, and here it is, 9:30 already. He's still not at work. He's not flexible enough still to say, okay, I'm late for work, I'm going to take this other bike now. He's still focused on getting this bike fixed. And in the meantime, someone comes around and says, oh, thank God you're here. I have a problem with my bike. Can you fix it for me? So instead of making a decision, yes, leave me the bike here and I'll fix it when I get home, he says, yeah, sure, I'll fix it now. Heaps of time. I'll fix it now. So he starts fixing that bike as well. And so by 11 o'clock, he might roll into work. And his boss was ringing me like every week saying, what the hell are you doing with this man? Because he's not getting into work and you said he was going to be all right. So can you see, like, really simple tasks start to become mammoth and difficult, and just everyday things then start to become virtually impossible to do. The other problem with meth is this really long protracted withdrawal period. Now, I apologise for this. Everyone's going to laugh when they see this picture. I didn't think I would have a whiteboard, so I've just whiteboarded onto my slide. So we've got severity up the side. So if someone's using, you know, they're feeling really great, the symptoms are, you know, escalating, and then they might stop. What happens after that is one of three possible things. There's a crash period. Crash period is when you just sleep, nothing else happens, might get up every now and then to have something to eat. After the crash, what might happen is nothing. You might just get up and feel okay, no withdrawal symptoms. Or you might actually have withdrawal, and over about 1 to 14 days. Or there may be no crash period at all, you may just go straight into withdrawal. So this complicates the picture a little bit. It's really hard to predict what's going to happen when someone stops using. The other issue for meth users is that you can see the initial withdrawal period is 1 to 14 days. So it's about 2 weeks. It's about usually about 10 days to 2 weeks, which is a bit longer than usual for other drugs. So we've got to take into account this acute period, but also you can see this long tail of withdrawal that even at 18 months, dopamine levels are still only about 80% of normal. So 18 months is still not functioning perfectly normally. Getting better all of the time, but these withdrawal symptoms, even though the drugs are out of the system, the brain changes are so significant that some of these deficits last for a very, very long time. All right, so what we've got here is, in long-term regular users, some significant brain changes that result in really strong cravings, variable motivation because of the action of both serotonin and dopamine on the brain, an impaired ability to manage emotions because the prefrontal cortex isn't working very well and not talking to the emotional centres, impaired higher order thinking processes like planning and decision making. That puts people at very high risk of relapse, and there's on top of that, this goes on forever. It goes on for like 18 months or possibly more, maybe 2 years before it starts to ameliorate. So we've got a very, very complex situation, and I'm telling you what you already know. I know that it is complex. But it just then makes everything a little bit harder. So I think what we need to do is think a little bit outside our normal kind of ways that we have alcohol and drug treatment. This kind of intensive group therapy idea, that's probably not going to cut it with most meth users, at least in the initial phases of the first year. Other things that are quite difficult might be like long waiting lists without support because of the impulsivity. So we need to provide that support while they're on waiting lists. And look, these are things that we probably should be doing for every client if we have the money to do that. But it's just, 1,000 times more for people on meth. Other things are things like having appointment times that are really flexible. So flexible both in the length of time and the time of appointment. If you have a meth user ring up and say, I really need to speak to someone, they really need to speak to someone now because in a week's time they've probably forgotten about the whole thing or they've lost motivation for it and you've lost them then. I just out of interest, and this is of no relevance to the talk at all, but see the man at the top with the bald head. I just pinched this photo because it was group therapy and it was really cute, but that's Carl Rogers for all of you counsellors. I realised later. All right, so these are some of the things I think we need to do. We need to have a priority focus on managing cravings. We do that anyway, but we often do that kind of later in relapse prevention or a bit later when withdrawal's kind of all over and people are starting to, recognise their triggers and all of those things. Then we start to talk about cravings. But I think we need to do that right at the beginning for meth users. We need to work really hard to keep them motivated because the brain is not functioning well enough to self-motivate. So we need to do things like, this is why contingency management works really well for meth users. It's been really successful in the US. We don't do very much of it here. And in fact, I think outside of a research setting, people don't do it very much in the US either. But if you can provide incentives and rewards for people to come to treatment, then they're much more likely to turn up. But we need to activate our empathy 1,000-fold and our motivational interviewing skills because this group is super hard to motivate into treatment. Emotional regulation is a big issue. So we need to make sure that we're assessing and monitoring that very closely. But things that I think that we neglect some of these really basic things that are probably okay to not worry too much about for other drug users, but for meth users, just knowing what to eat after long periods of not really eating very much. So nutrition, education about nutrition, education about sleeping well. Now we need serotonin in order to sleep, and when your serotonin's depleted, then it's really hard to sleep, but you can still rest. So my advice usually is don't worry about not sleeping. It's okay. You're not going to be able to sleep. Your serotonin's all stuffed up. But just lie down and rest anyway, even if you stay awake, because your body needs to regenerate, even if your brain's still kind of awake. And we need to do things. Behavioral activation is a term that psychologists use, but I think we call it activity scheduling. It sounds more sensible. And that's, you know, just having some structure in the day and planning, and because those planning centres and the structure is not there naturally, we have to help our clients with that level of planning. Now, this cognitive changes are what we've been talking about, but there may be things like more frequent, shorter sessions. So I know that I'm a psychologist, so I do 1-hour sessions once a week. That's the usual thing that I would do. But for meth users, I might change that a little bit. I might see them twice a week for a shorter session, or actually I might see them once a week for a longer session, because if they're a bit distracted and it takes them a really long time to get their story out, I might schedule 1.5 hours instead. We need to use lots of repetition because the memory is really poor. We need to use lots of written materials because memory is not very good. We need to go at a really slow pace. So just one idea per session, whether it's group or individual. Don't try and pack a whole bunch of stuff into one session. And we need to just concentrate on the really concrete material, because the concrete stuff comes back faster than the abstract stuff in the brain. So early on, we can just talk about triggers and structure and eating well and all of that, and leave all of the cognitive, the ACT, the narrative therapy, till much, much later, like 12, 18 months down the track. And I think with this, in terms of relapse, I find it really helpful to explain some of these brain changes to my clients, and it helps them to not worry so much that there's something wrong with them and that it's all their fault, that it's just that it's going to take a long time. You have to be realistic. It is going to take a long time to change. So explaining some of this stuff to clients is really helpful, I find really helpful. But also explaining that there is going to be this really long recovery time. You're not going to feel well for a year. And finding ways not to relapse in that time just because you're not feeling that great. So we need much more assertive follow-up with this client group. So normally, this is not good practice, but I do it anyway. Normally, if someone doesn't show up for one of my sessions, I would just wait till they rang me again. I don't bother to phone them up. And I know that in places where I've worked before, if someone didn't show up, we didn't really bother following them up. We might have sent them a letter, or the receptionist might have called at some point if they were lucky. But if they rang and made another appointment and they cancelled 3 times, it was kind of a 3 strikes, you're out, don't bother following up at all. But with this group, because it's not, I really believe it's not because they don't want to be here, it's just because they can't. It's really hard for them. If they don't come to their appointment, 5 minutes after they're meant to be there, give them a call and say, are you coming? Where are you? Or if they have kind of turned up late to their appointment, then you might need to just accommodate that a little bit more. So some assertive follow-up, very assertive follow-up, more assertive than we normally would have. And the priority needs to be on treatment retention, so keeping them in treatment. Now, these are things that we sometimes think, well, it's not, you know, not engendering independence in our clients, and we're trying to model them kind of getting back on track on their own and having empowerment. But because of these brain changes, it's very, very difficult for meth users to do that, even if they wanted to, and we have to scaffold them a lot in the first year. So, look, I am, as I said, looking forward to what ReGen have been doing, because I know they've been doing some very good work here, and some of these things they have trialled. But here's just some ideas, I guess, about things that we can do that are much more helpful for methamphetamine users than we normally might do, for example. And there's no... I'm being a bit vague here, I guess, because there aren't really any strategies that we've tried, but knowing what we know about the brain and the course of recovery, we can have a guess at what might be some differences and some changes that we need to make to our service provision that we can have a play around with and see if they work or not. So there's things like don't have a 7-day withdrawal because they've not finished their withdrawal in 7 days. They need about 14 days. I don't know how we talk to the funder about doing that, but having a longer withdrawal period is really important. Normally for other drugs, withdrawal starts right when they stop using. For meth users, there's a big, you know, 3-day crash period often. So there's not really much point in bringing them into inpatient care during that period because they won't do anything. They just want to sleep the whole time and they'll annoy everybody else that has to go to group or has to get up and have breakfast. We usually have waiting times for appointments, and I know even in places where I've worked, you know, where there's lots of practitioners and there's appointment times available, even when there's appointment times available in the day, the receptionist will always give them the next day's appointment. So we need to think about whether we can actually be a bit more flexible with our appointment system, I guess, and if there's an appointment that afternoon, then just book them in and get them to come in straight away and not wait for days or weeks. Obviously, if there's a waiting list, there's a problem. But as I was saying before, normally we have 1-hour counselling sessions if you're a counsellor, but you might want to have more flexible sessions, so hour and a half sessions if someone... So my engineer, salesperson, he initially, in the first 6 months, he was all over the place and he'd be talking to me about something and then he'd be off on a tangent, and so our sessions would just go on forever just to talk about one strategy that he could put into place. So I just started... I stopped booking him in for an hour and I started booking him for an hour and a half. I still told him it was an hour, but I allowed extra time just in case. And then as he got better towards the end of a year that I'd seen him, then we actually had shorter sessions because that's all he needed, but his concentration was still pretty poor. So if I talked to him for an hour or he talked to me for an hour, then we just started talking about the same thing over and over again. So I started seeing him... twice a week for half-hour sessions instead of once a week for an hour and a half. So having that more flexible way that we interact and make appointments and all of that stuff is very helpful. Now, because of the brain problems with after using meth, concentration and emotional regulation, sometimes sitting in a group is quite difficult for a meth user, and there are some meth-specific groups, and I think, without any evidence, just anecdotally, that they work better for meth users, at least in the initial phases, than throwing them in with a whole bunch of other drug users who tend to be a lot more settled in a group. So that might not be your experience, and if it's not, then that's good, but we need to think about who we've got in front of us, really, and what they need. And if they are not going to sit in a group, then we need to not put them in a group. I think don't force them into a group. I think I've talked about all those other things, so I'll just leave those with you. But I think that the point is that there's a whole range of innovative things that I'm sure my unimaginative brain hasn't thought of that you can think of that you could try and put in place for meth users, knowing what you know about how their brain works and how long it takes for those brain functions to recover. There's no science behind that. This is what we call practice-based evidence, right? We generate it ourselves, try out a few things, measure it and see if it it works or not, and then keep doing it if it's working, and stop doing it if it's not working. And that's, I think that's where we are with meth users now. I think we need to stay calm, keep calm and carry on, but also think about who we've got in front of us, because we know what to do. I'm pretty sure we know what to do. It's just that it needs a bit more tailoring for this group. That's a flexible step up, step down model. So thank you for listening. If you want to have a chat to me later, here's all the various high electronic ways that you can contact me afterwards. And I'm really looking forward now to hearing about how ReGen have kind of put some of this into action. Thank you.
A lot of insight into the issues that are certainly coming to services in relation to treating ICE users. We've probably got time for a couple of quick questions, only a couple. Is there anybody who wants to ask a question? Yep, down in the back.
I was just going to ask a quick question. Talk a lot about for the long-term users and et cetera, et cetera. Have you got some rough time frame that you use to distinguish between long-term users and perhaps patients? When you're talking about those things,
No. The short answer is no, because everybody's brain's a bit different and is affected by meth in a different way, and it depends on how much they're using and over what period of time. I guess what we do know is that if you're using three or four times a week for several months, there's a high likelihood of becoming dependent. So that might be a period of time that would flag that there might be some brain changes. I think the important thing, I didn't really talk about assessment or anything like that, but I think the important thing is to do a good assessment and to find out whether people are having trouble. Do you have trouble getting to appointments? Are you having trouble kind of planning your day? Do you find that you're late all the time? Although I'm late all the time too, so it's not really that helpful. But, you know, so just really talking to someone, just chuck out the tick box assessment form and talk to them and find out what's happening in their lives and how they're functioning, and that's probably the best indicator of whether they're going to have problems or not.
Just one more quick question, Daddy.
What are the considerations with dual diagnosis in terms of therapy and understanding different times?
Yeah, I think that that's a really good question. Just about all meth users will have some mental health problems, so I think we just have to assume that there's comorbidity there. And the same applies, I guess, when you're doing, if you wanting to do some treatment for depression as well, for example, is that what you're asking? Yeah, the brain changes are still there, and they're still going to have difficulty taking on new information and consolidating it and incorporating it and using it. So again, everything just needs to be a bit slower and a bit more carefully explained, I guess.
I'm just wondering how much masking there is of the symptoms or side effects of methamphetamine as to the diagnosis of mental health.
Oh, okay. So I guess my view about diagnosis of mental health is I don't really worry about it too much. I just ask people about their symptoms. And it doesn't really matter if their symptoms meet diagnosis or not. I don't care about that, because even if they've got very mild symptoms, I want to treat them. I want to see if I can kind of do something to help them fix that. So in that sense, it probably doesn't matter. But what we've got is a collection of symptoms, which probably includes some mental health problems as well that we need to address. And I think it's my approach is much more symptom oriented than diagnostic, being a psychologist, I guess.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just going to take one more question from the gentleman here, because he had his hand up before.
Thanks,
sir.
What views
are Yes. So, we've just done a really big review of pharmacotherapy treatment. It's a huge review, and the ANCD commissioned it, and it should come out soon, I hope. But we again just found that there was nothing helpful. I know that in withdrawal units we often give people benzodiazepines for their withdrawal, but there's absolutely no evidence that that's effective at all. I'm not saying don't do it, sorry, but the evidence is very thin, and the evidence that we do have suggests that there's nothing that's universally useful. There are a few things that are possibly useful for some people, but they're all going to be off-label prescribing, so you know, technically we shouldn't really be doing it. But things like, there's been some research that shows that bupropion is not generally helpful, but for light users, so people who are using less than 18 days in a month, that has much more effect on their recovery than people who are using more than 18 days a month. Yeah. But I don't think we can rely on the medication at this point.
Okay, Nicole is going to be on the panel later, so if you've got other questions too around this, please keep them in mind, because there will be that opportunity to ask other questions. But we do have to move on, because obviously, as I said, we are running to a tight schedule. So I'd now like to introduce Mel Dorrian, who's the team leader at non-residential withdrawal at ReGen. Mel's a registered nurse with extensive experience in the Victorian AOD treatment sector, particular in the area of managing opioid replacement therapies. He's the team leader of ReGen's non-residential withdrawal service and was a project leader for ReGen's exploratory study into methamphetamine withdrawal. And speaking with Mel will be Rose McCrone, who's our manager at Curran Place Adult Residential Withdrawal Unit. After commencing her AOD career at Pleasant View, Rose has been part of the first home-based and outpatient withdrawal teams in 1996 at Box Hill Hospital, becoming the manager of Wellington House in 1998. She supported YSAS residential service nursing staff and has managed Curran Place, ReGen's adult community residential withdrawal service, since 2005. And Rose became Victoria's first alcohol and drug nurse practitioner in 2009. Rose and Mal are going to talk about small changes and difference, adapting established service models to cater for methamphetamine. So, over to Mal and Rose.
Yeah, hi everybody. I'm, as Warren said, I'm Mel Dorrian. I run the non-residential withdrawal team here. I'm a nurse, and I've obviously worn this shirt to distract from the content of my presentation. Last year we conducted an audit of clinical practice where we looked at people undergoing methamphetamine withdrawal at Curran Place, and one of the most, it wasn't really robust research, but one of the most significant things that we found from that was that people leaving the unit after 7 days had, or at least half the people leaving the unit after 7 days had withdrawal symptoms at least as severe as those that they came in with. So as Nicole said in her presentation, the 7 day duration isn't adequate. So now, along with Nicole's assistance, we're looking at trialling a variation of the treatment model where we increase the time and support that we offer to clients and just in a variety of environments, so with home-based combined with inpatient, then combined with home-based again, to see if we can improve treatment outcomes and retention. There's not a lot that's known about methamphetamine withdrawal, as Nicole was saying, so we're really keen to grow the body of knowledge on this ever-increasing drug issue that we hear more and more about. So we'll take a brief look at how the treatment's going to work, and I apologise to any Daves in the audience, and I know there are Daves in the audience, so, but Dave is the person that we're going to talk about today. And Dave's a guy in his mid-20s, and he's been smoking about 2 points of ice 4 days a week straight for about a year. It's led to a breakdown of his relationship, a reprimand at work. He's in financial troubles and he's got a few other issues, so he decides to do something about it. So he calls ReGen to ask for assistance. It's picked up by the triage worker who he speaks to that he's got an issue with methamphetamine, so he gets tagged for the evaluation of treatment that we're going to do. So Dave's given the first available assessment appointment, which he attends. And when he attends this appointment, above the standard turning point developed evidence-based assessment model, that's the standard statewide now, We measure the severity of his dependence using the severity of dependence scale, and we also look at his quality of life using the World Health Organization scale as well. Everybody who goes through assessment at ReGen gets presented at clinical review, which is a meeting we have each day at 3 o'clock, where there's a panel of clinicians who hear each presentation, who formulate a treatment plan that then gets offered back to the client. And Dave has said that he's interested in doing an inpatient withdrawal. The clinical review panel agree with that, and so that plan gets offered back to Dave and he accepts it and it's initiated. His assessment verifies and quantifies his issue with crystal methamphetamine, and he's been allocated. He's been accepted into the inpatient withdrawal program. This triggers his placement on the waiting list for the inpatient withdrawal unit, but he also goes on to the non-residential withdrawal program waiting list as well. And as suggested by Nicole, we will make contact with him as quickly as possible to support him into the during the waiting period that he inevitably have to go through to get into the inpatient service. Now, during this time, we're going to offer him support, and this will either be by home visits, by outpatient appointments. We're trialling iPods, we're using Skype, so we can provide him with iPad. We're providing him with an iPad that's got Skype on it, and so we'll be able to, multiple times a day, make sort of screen-to-screen contact with him to see how he's going. With these, we can also do telephone support. There are a few variables like distance and safety concerns and other things that will determine what type of support Dave gets. When we make contact with him, he'll get supportive counselling. We'll look at his medications and how he's taking them, relapse prevention education, and we'll go through post-withdrawal planning as well. We'll also monitor... We will be monitoring the severity of the withdrawal symptoms that he's experiencing, and we use a thing called the amphetamine cessation symptom assessment, or the ACSA, which is a 16-question subjective scale that was developed in South Australia, and lists all of the predictable withdrawal symptoms people might go through and gives them an opportunity to rate the severity of them. And We'll use this tool consistently from the duration, so for his pre-admission support, during his stay on the unit, and then afterwards as well. This is the tool that we used in the audit of clinical practice that showed us that people's severity of symptoms wasn't over or hadn't decreased for at least half of them in the 7-day stay. So, deprived of the stimulant effects of methamphetamine, Dave crashes to compensate for the sleep debt that is built up during his amphetamine binge that lasts for a few days. As Nicole said, this doesn't happen to everybody, and there's a possibility that we may get a few hints to it's more likely to happen to or who isn't when we undergo our little project. Also, as Nicole said, he's accumulated a nutritional deficit because of the appetite suppressant effects of the methamphetamine, so he hasn't been eating well for a few days. So a strong component of what the support that we're going to give Dave is nutritional advice, and that will continue when he goes onto the unit as well. The non-residential withdrawal nurse will accompany Dave to see his GP referred her to Turning Point's alcohol and other drug withdrawal prescribing guidelines, which are evidence-based. And even though there isn't a huge amount of evidence, as Nicole said, they represent the collective knowledge, and they're written by experts, so they're the best guide that we really have. And as Nicole said, they're not much use, but he gets prescribed low-dose short-term benzodiazepines for his agitation and paracetamol for a headache. The non-residential withdrawal nurse will work with Dave to assist his withdrawal management, and with his GP, if they identify a need for a mental health care plan, that'll be put into place, and then they have the ability to line up a 10 session or 6 or 10 sessions of counselling from a psychologist that Dave can use after his inpatient treatment as well. He's now ready to be admitted to the unit, so I'll hand across to Rose to talk about that. Thanks, Rose.
I'm Rose, I manage our inpatient unit. And I thought I'd give you a little bit of insight to some of the experiences that we have. One of the changes that Karen Place contributed to this whole process was when people started to present to treatment, we found that they were coming in, and anyone doing their crash phase with us was probably not doing very well. And part of that was because, I'll admit it, we ran quite a strict regime in our program about when you had to get up. And I think there was also a clash of expectations of people coming into treatment. It's an inpatient unit of 12 beds. It's on the one hand, it's peaceful, but it's busy. And it's a monitored environment, so it's very natural for us to check in with people. And unfortunately, this resulted in some people getting a little bit grumpy. And in fact, we had some very, very aggressive incidents in the unit, which helped drive for us this question and the review about, like, really, what are we doing for people that come in? Because you just can't really lay around for 3 days. However, we reviewed our program, and what we've gone and implemented is a much more flexible structure in the first 3 days, and it's for all people. We didn't just say this is just for methamphetamine users. We did this for all people coming off alcohol, cannabis, and it's worked really, really well. So now, in the example that Mel was talking about for someone like Dave coming in, we would also, on admission, do the ACSA and the severe substance dependence scale. Now, it's a little bit difficult sometimes to do that if the person is crashing. We don't exclude anyone, but it's certainly recommended that they try and do that at home. So we're trying to link across our programs, except that that's not happening for some of the people. And there are a lot of people who won't have used for a week and then they happen to use very heavily in the few days before they come to us. We would never exclude anyone, but certainly, I love the word that you used, Nicole, that they would annoy people. That's such a tactful word. Look, it just doesn't work necessarily if someone is wanting to get up at unreasonable hours and, you know, why should I go to your program and how dare you wake me up? But for people who are coming in and their crash was 2, 3, 4 days ago, they are doing much, much better. They usually are up within 48 hours and participating in the program. I guess what we also saw as well was, I think in my head, we had grouped all methamphetamine users as the one type. And one of the things that stood out for me in particular was the emergence of a new group of people who had never sought treatment before. And they were from the construction or businesses related to construction. They had relationships, they had houses. And through their ICE use over the last couple of years, they had actually run their families into financial ruin. So they were presenting to us with all of these issues on the line. And at somewhere along the way had lost the ability to get themselves out of this situation. We were also seeing that clients who were known to us, who had previously had other substances that they were dependent on, they joined the ice age. They started to pick it up as well. One of the questions that was asked about mental health, we started to notice that so if someone was a daily user, they definitely had the crash. The people that were using 3 to 4 times a week were usually pretty good. The group who really struggled the most were particularly young men. If they had a low prevalence disorder that was previously diagnosed and they were being treated for it, they would often come in, they would crash for 4 days, and then they wouldn't be able to get out of bed on days 5, 6, and 7. So really they were progressing to a depressive episode. And they were the group that we probably have to be the most flexible with, and are probably, I guess they're getting more and more unwell. And these are the group who we would probably look to support the most, and it looks like it will be a lot of ongoing support for them. So I guess it was really useful to start saying, actually, I need to ask a lot more questions about the people's crash, and does it happen, and how do you cope? And I guess in my head, now we don't have a lot of this evidence, and you know what the evaluation that we did, yes, it was quite crude, and we're working with Nicole at the moment to try and get some structure around that. But we started to see the different types and different treatment approaches. In terms of the medications, yeah, I mean, we're giving people benzodiazepines. More and more, if you have already done your crash before and so you haven't used for 3 or 4 days before you get to us, you don't end up taking any medication. You usually just take a few vitamins. And it's really probably benzodiazepines for retention in care. It's probably behavioural management, because as much as the vast majority are really, really good, some people that we're getting, they're grumpy. Now, they were probably grumpy before they even picked up methamphetamines, but this has not helped. And so knowing that what had happened for us is that we had to have people discharged very, very early in the first 24 hours because their outbursts were unmanageable. But now I think as an intake team and as a group overall, we've managed to find a lovely balance, and I think people's expectations are much better. And then, look, we still get people to attend the group. They need to start going into the group by the fourth day. And it's not just methamphetamine users. You get a lot of people who go, oh, why should I go to your group? But the symptoms that Nicole talked about in terms of thinking and planning, many, many years ago, we allowed people to, you know, maybe self-regulate their behaviour more. And you think, oh, yes, they'll get up. They'll want to go to the group program, that it's voluntary. But what we found is that with most of the people that come to us seem to be stuck in their life and have lost the ability to get themselves out of the situation that they're in. And that behaviour continues when you come into the withdrawal unit. Yes, you may not use your drug and you're away from your environment, but generally people would still go, oh, I'll stay up till 2 a.m. and then I'll wake up and I'll have a coffee and a cigarette for breakfast, and then I'll just want to chain smoke and watch bad daytime television. So, and crave Coca-Cola. Oh, it's always Coke. No one craves Sprite. Anyway. And so what we found is that we're in this really sad situation where we have to put a structure in, but then people say to us, thank God you gave this structure to me. And the structure involves, you know, getting up at a reasonable hour and having breakfast. So we set the table, and because it's there, people go, I think I'll eat breakfast. And you'll hear comments like, I haven't eaten breakfast in years. And so then going to the program is, and it's actually not that intensive. It's really only 3 to 4 meetings spread throughout the day. But what we find is that people then have a bit of purpose to the day. And the group program is starting to help people work out how they will move forward from this situation. So I think all people should end up going to the group. Otherwise, they're probably not doing a lot by just being there for 7 days. The other thing too, you know, you use the word nutrition. We've been eaten out of house and home by some of the people recovering from methamphetamine. We had this beautiful man who I needed to catch up with because I was, you know, prescribing for him. And he was eating this slab of lasagna. You know how people exaggerate? And it was not exaggerating. It was huge. And I said to him, oh, no, all right, just finish your breakfast and then come and see me. And he's going, oh, this is my second piece. And they describe that, yeah, they're just so distracted and eating is so unimportant during the time that they're using. So, yeah, they get up and they just eat and eat and eat. But it's really, really beneficial. And I think I think we're probably at a point where we've started to get really comfortable. I think initially we were searching around going, where's the pharmacological answer? Because we're so used to having a pharmacological response to all the other drugs. But I think now we've been able to really see that the supportive environment that is offered is incredibly beneficial. And, you know, if we can do this, and we have done it with people and it's worked very, very well, that they do a step up and a step down. And I would have to say that we've seen some repeat episodes, but I'm not seeing people come back, I guess, the way that we see them, you know, with similar to alcohol and other substances. But because we're not following people up long term, I don't know what's happened to some of these people. Now, I'm aware of time and Lawrence's anxiety levels, so back to you, Mel.
So we
should have rehearsed this beforehand, shouldn't we?
So whilst the clients are in the unit, we're going to have one of the home-based withdrawal or non-residential nursing team in there for half a day to establish contact with the client and to inform them the process that goes on afterwards. And once when they're discharged from the unit, my team will continue to follow them up, and we're talking now for maybe 2 months afterwards to monitor the severity of their withdrawal and see what we can learn from it. And we're going to have it all evaluated and see how it turns out. If anyone's interested in the audit of clinical practice that we did last time and that resulted in this trial that we're doing this time, there are copies of it available in the foyer that you can grab at the break or on your way out. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Ben. We are running behind time, so I'd ask if people do have questions. I'll take one question. Have we got a burning question that they need to ask? No? Good. Oh, okay. Just made it.
Sorry, is that to have a therapy on the connection for the doctor's and I do find lots of referrals I've got. I choose these people, and the problem I'm setting up a group for people to opt into, which is going to be quite difficult to establish, but we are going to try. And my question is about the use of benzodiazepine in early stage withdrawal. I'm a little bit concerned about whether that may be another a crutch or addiction. And I take the point, it's very short term use. We don't prescribe, except for alcohol withdrawal, any benzodiazepine withdrawal. So I want your comments on using benzodiazepine treatment.
I feel like I'm a broken record with every single person that I give them to, regardless of their substance, whether it's methamphetamine, with every person. I mean, look, they're useful in alcohol withdrawal, but they're used across most substances. And to every person, we're having to say, I just don't want you to find this as your new addiction, and it is a major problem. But yes, I guess... So we make sure that we reduce people by the end of the fifth or the sixth day. The doses are very low. They're done on an as-needed basis. And this whole staff group spend a lot of time talking to people about saying you need to not find this on an ongoing basis. At the same time, I think what's happened with alprazolam has created a huge wave of people struggling to get access to benzodiazepines overall. So I think it's over for the benzos era. Now, they're still around, but we are certainly really cautious about introducing people. And look, we find with a lot of people, if they've come to us and they haven't used for 3 or 4 days, we might write them up and they're unlikely to take them. Yeah, so, but it's still it's a problem. But in the absence of anything to treat methamphetamine withdrawal specifically, and that's what I mean, it's behavioural management. And I don't think we have anything really for, you know, how to manage your grumpy mood and, yeah. Yes. And that's what I mean. A lot of it for us is just driven in the structure of the program. Like, we have to turn the TV off, and sometimes people grumble, and you go, oh. So we turn it off, and then they go, oh, okay, I'll get into bed. And then they experience that if you get into bed at an appropriate time and you reduce stimulus and you haven't had, you know, 23 coffees a day, because that's the other thing that you don't realise that happens in a withdrawal unit. People will double their tobacco intake, and they will usually, I mean, nearly everyone has a white coffee with three sugars, and then they'll have, you know, 7 or 8 of them a day. Like, we have to have banned V and Guarana, Coca-Cola. Now, Bill. And it's really interesting how people really turn to caffeine and sugar cravings, and then, yeah, they find they don't sleep as well. So a lot of what we do is the logistical management of good sleep patterns, and then people wake up, they're less grumpy, and they go, I actually slept overnight. And, but it doesn't appear to happen naturally for people. They need us to impose that.
Thanks for that, Rose. I guess a couple of comments I wanted to make, I guess, was really around the fact that, you know, all the speakers this morning so far have been talking about the flexible approach, which, you know, traditionally was not something that was actually encouraged within alcohol and drug services. And I think certainly one of the first things that we did, you know, as Rose was talking about and Mel was talking about, I've got a pretty loud voice anyway. Sorry. So one of the things that that has been key was the fact that, as Rose and Mel were talking about, January last year we actually undertook a 6-month trial in terms of what would work better for people who were coming through the doors with methamphetamine use that, you know, obviously previously had just been leaving after those couple of days. And that's been really important in one, and I'd really like to thank the Department of Health, because they, once we did that trial, actually funded another non-residential withdrawal nurse so that we could actually continue the program of looking at, you know, over a 4-week period, the process of firstly, as Mel was talking about, having that first step with the non-residential withdrawal, working through the crashes, then going into withdrawal units, and then being supported afterwards. And that's made such a difference. And it's been great too, because then we've been able to, because we've got that funding, we've actually been able to afford to have the program evaluated, which I think is absolutely critical for future use. Now we're going to sort of take a slightly different tack, and I would like to introduce Bill Parasitis, who's the consumer participant. And Bill has spent many years working in a leadership capacity in the corporate sector. He's also used a number of ReGen services and is an active consumer participant. He is committed to contributing his expertise to informed, improved treatment services and assists others affected by AOD dependence, particularly in relation to methamphetamine. And speaking with Bill will be Regina Brindle, who's the consumer participation facilitator here at ReGen. Okay, all right.
Can you work on the consumer?
Yes, I can certainly do that. So I'd really like to welcome all the consumers in the audience, I'll hand over to Bill to do his presentation, and his presentation's on consumer presentation, listening to consumers to improve treatment models. So, welcome, Bill.
I've got a loud voice like yourself.
Yeah, but I think it's for the internet. That's it.
Good morning, everybody. I've got a face for radio. First, I'd like to thank ReGen and all the speakers and presenters. They've made their time valuable. Well, valuable time here on a worthy cause, I believe. I've been personally struggling with meth use and dependency for 9 years. Gram-a-day habit, my habit. I was once in the banking and finance sector. I was once a loving father. Loving son, loving brother. an uncle and a friend. I emphasise the word was. I seem to have become estranged from all those things that I once was, and through ReGen's support, I'm working on reconnecting with everything that I've lost. The laws that I've broken, the negative impact I've had on the community with preying on the weak, the vulnerable, the sick, selling the mice just to feed my own demon, manipulated, took advantage of, just to fuel my demons and my desires and to instill power and control on those less fortunate than myself. In essence, my addiction became my world. It consumed my life to a point of a pinprick. It only consisted of fellow meth addicts and meth environments. My existence was solely dedicated to my addiction. Who I once was, what I once wanted, everything I had achieved and anyone I'd loved became obsolete during my addiction. It vanished into thin air like the cloudy, cloud dreams I was blowing out of my glass pipe. Essentially, that's my truth, my reality. After many years of crystal meth abuse, I'd left myself broke, alone and homeless, living on the streets, finding shelter where I could, sleeping on carports. I'll tell you what, I had so many ants feeding off me. those ant bites, they get really annoying at nights. Eating out of food courts, the leftovers on the tables. You couldn't tell by looking at me, but yeah. Alone and scared, hungry, too proud to ask for help, too ashamed, embarrassed and humiliated to allow people once knew me to see me what I once, well, what I've become due to my crystal meth addiction. I just wanted to lose myself in my glass pipe with my cloudy, cloudy dreams and numb my pain, blind myself to seeing only white, consuming and swung up any other colours in the spectrum, blocking out all noises or sounds, becoming one with white. White had become my nothingness. I felt I was no longer here, there, or anywhere. I'd become an inanimate object. I no longer felt emotions. I no longer wanted anything from anyone except crystal meth. My addiction had almost led me to my extinction. I can't pinpoint the exact moment that gave me purpose to once again live. However, soon after that moment, anything and everyone that I had once loved and wanted and who I once was came floating back to me in fragmented images. And that was the moment I decided to walk into ReGen's doors. When I walked through those haunting doors, I tell you people, it was the scariest thing. You know, I was full of fear and hate and remorse and oblivious to logic and reality. I was lacking the ability to function in an everyday manner with an everyday community. Thank you once again, ReGen, for helping me find the ability to think and process and practice and work and implement and feel, understand and learn to accept life again. So can't thank you people enough here at ReGen, sincerely. The road to recovery is as treacherous as it is tedious. Tedious due to the amount of work, commitment, practice that's required until it becomes muscle memory. Treacherous because, as we all know, with hard work, it becomes boring, mundane, tedious. I mean, we just want to break that cycle again. And when we're thinking about breaking that cycle, we think about going back to, you know, fun times, good times, you know, which can often put us back into a dangerous environments that we once were familiar with, which can lead to a very treacherous road once again. I can confidently say without any doubt that the road to recovery is about developing new habits and not coming back to old habits. Upon my arrival here at ReGen in April 2013, I had a few hundred dollars on me and about 7 grams of crystal meth, which I scored the day before and I began hustling on the streets again. And I believed I was under police surveillance again and I was seeking refuge from them. I had a moment's peace in weeks, ducking, diving, weaving, staying ahead of the police and fellow addicts trying to steal my stash and my money. I was physically and mentally exhausted from that whole experience, just fearing for my life and fearing for my safety. I was looking for, safe haven, and ReGen's doors provided that, I believe. And my first day here, I walked in, the doors hadn't even opened, and I just waited and waited. As soon as I opened, I walked in and, full of paranoia, and I think everybody's a cop, it's an undercover cop. And they're all, looking at me. So, you can imagine my psychosis at the time anyway, people. So, I stuck around here till 5 p.m. And during that period of time, I managed to sleep for about an hour to 2 hours, and I finally found peace. And I had Counselor Lorella check on me during the course of the day just to make sure that, I'm okay. So... I remember that. So I just remember the cops looking at me. Cops, clients would be coming in. I thought every client worker was a cop, undercover cop. Thank you, Lorella, for your support wherever you are. Soon later, I actually, during my recovery, I came to understand I was experiencing ice-induced psychosis. I'll also mention shortly about my withdrawal psychosis. I was like clean for up to 90 days and I'm still experiencing psychosis. Prior to my entry, so I began counselling here approximately a week later, and then putting me up for detox stay at the current place. So I had to do the GP medical and the psychiatric assessments, which gave me the all clear to get into current place. Prior to my entering into current place, I'd made a conscientious decision to stop using crystal meth 14 days prior to my admittance, knowing full well that I only had 7 days in there. Now, I know 7 days is not enough. I didn't want to sleep through the process. I didn't want to miss out on activities. So I made that conscientious decision to get off crystal meth and stop using. So I started on, because I know, first day of detox, full of anxiety, you're just on the edge and you just, you think about scoring, you think about having a toke. And then days 3, 4, 5, and 6 for myself, I crash. I'm in the fetal position, rocking backwards and forwards. So, it just wasn't going to be a pleasant stay. It wasn't going to be a productive stay for me there if I went into detox on the first day to stop using. So I made that decision with the support of my partner at the time to give it up for 14 days prior entry and see how we go. The great thing about current place was it gave us an opportunity to reconnect with the community. It taught us nutrition, taught us sleep hygiene. There were some great classes in there, yoga, flexibility. We talk about flexibility, huh? However, there was one particular class that we did, it was on mindful smoking, which I really took on board in more ways than one. I valued it so much so that it became like my foundation, my platform for developing the skills once again to cognitive process, cognitive thinking. So it was an amazing experience for me. Instead of smoking a cigarette in like 3 minutes, we all know we play a smoke, put it in our mouth and we light it up and it's gone. How this process became a little bit more of a, an experience where we pull out a cigarette, we taste it, we smell it, we just admire the fumes travelling up into the air. But it was more than that. It was also about removing yourself from groups as well, all the idle chatter that's going on in the background or close by to you. So you just remove yourself from that and start to enjoy your environment and observe your surroundings. And you know what? Essentially for me, it was just about removing myself from everything and everybody and smelling the roses. So I actually practiced that. I started off once a day, then I said to myself, once a day doesn't cut it, because I can't remember if I did it yesterday or not. So, because the short-term memory loss with withdrawals is pretty, was, well, daunting experience for myself, because you tend to forget a lot of things. And I had a pen and paper so I can write things down. So I started doing that twice a day. Now I use that every day, twice a day. I still practice that mindful awareness technique every day without fail. Excuse me, guys, I've just lost my place here. I learnt sleep hygiene again in the detox. That was great. I hadn't slept for 6 months, I remember, a couple of years ago. I'd become so anal retarded on one particular thing at the time, and I stayed away for 6 months. Well, it seems that way to me anyway. So, and nutrition. And I've really made up for lost ground there, so it's great. Between my anxiety, my withdrawals, my pains, my sweat, my psychosis, I can tell you this much. The 14 days, if I went in there not detoxing, 14 days for myself wouldn't have been enough, especially being a heavy meth user. So, I mean, you know, please donate. Upon my release from I successfully completed current place, the detox there, and came back here and continued my sessions with Lorella. Then our time had finished, and it's like, well, I wasn't ready to let go of ReGen, and Lorella saw to it that I have another counsellor, and that was Jesse. And those sessions continued for a few more months, which was great, because, you know, I was scared, you know, I didn't believe I was ready to be left alone out there. So ReGen went beyond the call of their duty there. So soon after that, I got involved with a six-week module, I think it was called Keep Going, which was a group activity on Jesse's recommendation. And that was great for me because it was like, you know, reconnecting again, you know, reconnecting with people. And it made me feel like I was part of something bigger than just myself. So that was great, just to make it all relatable with other people. But here's a funny situation. I don't know if people talk about this, and I've never experienced this before. And this is a massive conflict for me because I was really struggling to keep my sanity. Withdrawal psychosis. It started for me when I entered Current Place, where I thought Current Place was actually a ASIO recruitment centre, and I was being groomed as a secret spy. And I started during my sleep, we had this smoke detector above our head, and every time it was flashing, you know, oh God, red, green, somebody had to put new batteries in those things. I was rolling. I was running from side to side. You know, like it was a form of, you know, physical activity. I'm running side to side, and this went on one night, all night long. So you know, you can imagine the that fear. You know, you're losing your mind. You know, then I started crouching. I was in the back in the basketball court, and I started crouching and, you know, staying still. Every time a car would approach or headlights, I'll see headlights or hear a car approach. I'm thinking I'm exercising to become James Bond or something. I mean, you know, and I kept all this to myself. I mean, you know, because I didn't want anybody to think I was going nuts, going crazy, or be labelled crazy and get locked up in a psychiatric ward again. Talk about meds there, huh? Pharmaceutical efforts. Excuse me. And whilst I was staying at my partner's home and with the two great kids, we're talking about three innocent people here, three people that have never experienced drugs or drug abuse or drug addictions. They don't have friends or family members that have ever used it. So we're talking about very innocent minds here, and they've got me in there. Could I give them a show, huh? Oh, geez. Yeah, thanks for your support, hon. Absolutely priceless. I'm in their home, and I'm practicing death blows. Their family dog You know, I thought that their family dog, its tail, was a listening device. Wag, 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 wag. It's still intact, huh? So that's all right. You know, I was fortunate to, I walked out tightrope, and I was very fortunate and, that I came out of it through the support of ReGen and my partner and her kids. Nobody told me about that sort of psychosis. I've been clean for 90 days at this stage, and I don't know what's real and what's not. I was having delusions. I'm trying to distinguish reality from delusional. And I tell you what, there was no support on that front. Mental health care services were lacking for myself. I was very disappointed about that. It's like, if I didn't have that support, a person of, I don't know, lesser mind, body, soul and spirit might have not succeeded, whereas I have. You know, that support I found to be lacking. I mean, the only time I actually had psychiatric support was October. It was a 1.5 hour tedious assessment, Northcare. And I tried to look and sound as crazy as I possibly could. I mean, I'd practiced it for years. that gave me the all clear, no ongoing psychosis and no ongoing depression. Fooled them, right? as well as I found that with Carmel, my partner, I should say, and her kids. I mean, we're talking three innocent minds, and there was really no support services for the support network that that us recovering addicts don't have. I mean, we're talking about innocence here, and because of their innocence, there's ignorance, and that sort of ignorance can be destructive and detrimental to all parties involved, especially to a recovering crystal meth addict, where their good is actually being negated through their lack of knowledge and understanding of the situation at hand. As we all know, with knowledge comes power and understanding, and that's where, you know, possibly more funding should be dedicated to treatment along those lines with education as well. You know, as we all know, prevention is, you know, essentially education and treatment. And educating children essentially from, you know, primary school to through to the end of secondary on the dangers of drug abuse and drug addiction would probably be beneficial, no doubt. Drugs really have no boundaries, no borders, no prejudices, no biases. There's no religious or race vilifications with drugs. There's no judgments. We want just all, they say. So, you know, let's not forget, you know, I mean, I have a daughter and, we, you know, they're all targets. We're all targets for drug abuse. And as we know, you know, treatment would require more research, more funding, more facilities, and especially with treatment with recovering addicts. As we all know, it's easy to lapse, it's easy to relapse. So let's not allow a recovering addict to become once again an addict. It's easily occurring at the moment. I mean, if I didn't have the support and chase the support and stay strong, I would have failed on many occasions. You know, more funding obviously towards education and treatment, which is probably the best way to combat the war on drugs. Minimise demand, thus minimise supply, rather than countless of hundreds of million dollars spent by our governments chasing the Mr. Bigs. As we all know, drugs will always be there in our community, only as long as there is a demand for it, people. So thank you for your time and thank you for your exercise.
Thanks, Bill, for that that account. That was very strong, and obviously, you know, even though a lot of us have been working in that field, don't really understand, you know, the issues that people go through day to day, and that, you know, incredible stress and that, as you talked about, psychosis. So we really appreciate you telling your story to us today. Yeah, thanks again for that, and I wish you another applause. We're going to take a 10-minute break now while the panel sets up. If people could, if you want a cup of tea or coffee or whatever, bring it back, because we're going to start sharply in 10 minutes. The panel will be the opportunity to talk and ask questions about a lot of what you've heard today, and also hear some other information around what's happening around methamphetamine. So thanks very much.
you realise I'm not awake yet? Yep, that's coming. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Sorry, I'm doing roadie counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Thank you for thinking about me in regards to that training. You got it. No, I just think you're going to. Yep. 1, 2, 4, 5, 8, 9, 10, 10, 10. 1, 2. Yep. You're right? You're right for that one? Cool. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Yep, yep, yep.
Cup of tea or something?
No, I'm fine, thanks. I hang out on every word.
Thank you.
Brandon to do something. Brandon said that he was happy to do that.
Yeah, it's a bit distracting.
Are you going to introduce the speakers?
Yeah, all right, so I'll just introduce you. That's good. Thank you. Just want to say hi. good to see you. The roving one?
Yeah.
I think Brandon. Okay, we're going to start. If people could take their seats and we'll start again. We are running about 10 minutes, 15 minutes over time. I just wanted to check whether it was okay if we actually went 15 minutes over time. Is that generally okay with everyone?
Yep,
all right, thank you. There were so many responses when we talked about the iPads that we're giving clients that I thought I would show you the iPad. It looks like one of those computers that my child had about 10 years ago. They play whatever they were, play school, whatever it is. But the idea is that it can be dropped, but I'm not going to do that. Just so, but it can be dropped and it still works. And obviously, it's pretty well sealed so that people can't put other programs on. And they can only access what we really wish them to access. So, but that's how we're doing the iPad. So the client would get that, have that in their keeping while they are going through the first process or with the non-residential withdrawal team. And I don't believe we've lost any yet, so that's really positive. So I'm now going to introduce Trevor King, who's the facilitator for this session. Trevor's the manager of therapeutic services at ReGen. Trevor's worked in the drug and alcohol field for over 30 years. During this time, he's held senior clinician education, policy, service management, and other positions in both the government and non-government sectors. Roles include the Deputy Director of Turning Point Alcohol and Drug Centre, Deputy Director of the Drug Policy Modelling Program, University of New South Wales, and at Burnett Institute Centre for Research Excellence into Injecting Drug Use. So I'll hand over to Trevor now, who will be introducing the panel. Thanks, Trevor. I know, okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Lawrence. And this is the opportunity where we can engage with the audience. So this session primarily is about methamphetamine use, and we've touched on dependence, and we've touched on treatment, but it's fair to say we've touched on the early phase, the very first step in the treatment process. I think Bill spoke about, you know, what sort of happens beyond that, but that's been the focus so far. So I encourage you, in terms of questions and answers, to think about the theme of the day, which is innovation. So that's the sort of a theme that I'd like us to continue with. I think on the program we said that that we might think about this session in the context of the AOD reforms. And I must say, overnight I got very concerned that we'd written that into the into the program, because I think quite easily it could become a free-for-all, because I know we're all very nervous about the reforms and where it's up to and where do we sit in the whole scheme of things. So I don't want it to be a free-for-all in relation to those issues. So if I can introduce the panel members. Nicole, I won't introduce, just to say that Nicole's agreed to be part of the panel, and that's fantastic. Helen Kennedy. Helen is the manager of family counselling, the Family Counselling Service over at the Victorian Aboriginal Health Service, and that's that service, as people here will know, has got a sort of a 40-plus years history of working on health in its broadest context for Indigenous people here in Victoria. So welcome to Helen. Donna Ribson-Turner, many people again will know Donna, who's the Director of Clinical Services here at ReGen. Can I then introduce Aileen Ashford, and she's the CEO of the Children's Protection Society. And I'll just say a couple of words, because people may not know, CPS is an independent non-government organisation with, once again, a very long history of working with focus in the northern and western parts of Melbourne. And the organisation fundamentally works to provide a safe and nurturing environment for kids. and then can I keep moving along and introduce Sam Biondo? And Sam is the Executive Officer of BARDA, the Victorian Alcohol and Drug Association, and it's the peak body for the Victorian Alcohol and Other Drug Services. What I thought we'd do in the first instance, given that Nicole's had an opportunity to speak, but others haven't, so what I've asked the panellists to do is, just in a very brief way, in 2 to 3 minutes, just to give a sense of methamphetamine use, dependence, any other issues that they might want to comment on, and its impact either on their service or on the sector that they might represent. So I don't really mind the order, but I think if we do it in an orderly way, we might start with you, Sam, and head that direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. been told to speak into the mic, but it was nearly empty, it's all right. Look, the issues for us are fairly complex on the one hand and fairly simple on the other. Our systems need to be adaptive to change in the alcohol and drug space. The reforms that are mooted for our alcohol and drug sector that are imminent provide an opportunity for us to move in and start to adapt to meet community demand. It's very disruptive and it creates a lot of pressures for us, but it does create some opportunities. Not that I'm a glass half full person at all, but I think given that we're going to go through this mess, we should learn to create systems which meet community demand, and methamphetamine is providing us with a number of challenges. You've heard a little bit about the way in which ReGen has met that challenge. I think as a broad system, we need to also consider that sort of thing. The impact on our drug treatment system across Victoria from surveys we've done with our service system indicates that it's a growing problem, and there's variable sort of knowledge or variable approaches to meeting that community demand. At the moment we've got some hyping up of these issues, but we need to be adaptive enough to try and put stuff on the ground that actually meets some of those concerns. Otherwise, some other systems will start to come into play, such as the prison system, law and order, and those approaches are incredibly destructive to people's lives. There are other things happening at a broader level, greater awareness on children, vulnerable children. Our system interfaces very closely with that, and I'm sure you'll speak a bit about that. There are moves afoot, which I think you might speak about, the family drug courts, to try and adapt so that we don't pluck children out, we don't disrupt families, don't put more pressures on them. They're not really complex, unachievable things to do. They can be done. We just need to reorient our service system. Governments can be inflexible, but we need to continuously go in with a policy push for change and adaptation. In many ways, if we provide some of these solutions, then they will allow us the flexibility to introduce new approaches. The other area of concern that I have is the prison system, and I think that the way in which it's structured, the amount of money that's going into that system, the harm that it's creating, is really at the wrong end of where the money needs to go. It needs to go into the prevention, needs to go into the treatment, needs to go up at the community level before things get too much more complex. And I think drug courts have got an interesting role to play that should be explored, particularly around the methamphetamine issue, to try and get things out of the prison system.
Thanks, Sam. Eileen.
Can you hear me better speaking to the microphone? No. Okay. I think it was really interesting listening to you, Bill, because what it clearly is this is not a class issue. As same as family violence, which is what we see in a lot of the families that we work with. But I suppose when I look at children and young people and families, I look at three sort of sets that come into our service. And one is those kids who are still at home and they've got drug issues in the family. And then we look at kids who are actually in out-of-home care, so they've gone into out-of-home care because of the drug issues. And then we've got those kids in out-of-home care who are now using ICE and are ending up in our juvenile justice system. And what we've got as a sector is a sector that doesn't really understand or have the knowledge that the drug and alcohol sector has about the, you know, what happens when you're on ICE or what are the effects, et cetera, et cetera. So we just need a really stronger way about how do we work together in a much more collaborative way. I mean, I think that, you know, child protection is your extreme end, but they'll always have a risk management framework that they're very clear and structured around. And the out-of-home care services system is also incredibly structured. And for those kids who have come from, you know, chaotic families where they are actually using drugs, it's not working for them. And I think that we're seeing that in a variety of things across the sector. One thing that is happening, which I don't know whether, you know, I'm sure you all know, so I'm sorry if I'm telling you, you know, it's something you already know, is the child family drug court that they're going to do in Broadmeadows. I don't think it's started yet. Right. Yeah, which is a very, you know, good innovative approach to looking at how do you maintain and keep families together where there's a parent who is a drug user, and give them a wraparound support to enable them to either withdraw and get off the drug completely, or to come to a space where that they can function, you know, quite well as a parent and a family. And it's a very different way of working. It's not that sort of, you know, I suppose stringent, you know, you've got to fit the mould, or you're in or you're out sort of approach. I think that's going to have benefits, because when you talk to kids in out-of-home care, they just want to be with their family. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter if the family's mad, bad, or, you know, all those things, they actually want to be with their family.
Thanks, Alan. Donna, please.
Okay, well, Rose and Mel have already talked a bit about how we've tried to align our withdrawal services to work better with methamphetamine users. So I thought I'd just reflect a little bit about the process that we've been through at ReGen around the growing, I guess, hysteria around methamphetamine use. So this one went through three stages, and I think the first stage was really about observing and listening. So we had a bit of a look at how we've been doing, and we looked at our files over a 6-month period to see how long people were staying, what was going on, and came up with some real challenges and gaps. And then we listened to our clients who had experience, people like Bill, who could tell us some of the things that we needed to do for them and for their families. We had conversations with our staff who were working day to day with people and with our colleagues. So for example, we've had lots of conversations with VARs about the needs of Aboriginal people in our community around methamphetamine use. And we've been able to do some really good things coming from sensible conversations. So the second thing we did was sort of go away and reflect. And I think we've reflected in three ways. We engaged our brains in looking at the research. The help of people like Nicole, who could tell us some really obvious things. If you've got this problem, then you need to change how you're doing things to adapt to that. But we also listened, I think, with our hearts, and we tried to come from a compassionate point of view, because even though there was a bit of a feeling there wasn't good treatment, people were coming to us asking for assistance, lots of people. And so we tried to come from a point of view as looking at what people wanted and being compassionate in the services we offered. And then we listened with our gut. We looked at all that and we thought, what sounds right to give something a go? And I think that was the third thing we did. I said, we need to do something. We need to act somehow, try something, and then we can evaluate it and rethink if it's not working. And some of those things we did are obviously the step up, step down program. But we've also prioritised and made 2 beds in our adult withdrawal unit available for Aboriginal people. We've had a lot of support from the department in changing our model. So wonderfully, I'll tell you that in partnership with VARS and the department, we've just employed an Aboriginal worker to work in the adult withdrawal unit and support those 2 beds. And I guess the next phase is that evaluation phase. So using the expertise of people like Nicole to see, are any of these things making a difference?
Thanks, Donna. Helen.
Hi, how are you? Bill, can I just thank you so much for the presentation? And I've got to say, you're naturally a very funny man. Coming up I seriously, you've got so much material there. I can see you making. I will actually pay. Seriously, and well done.
It's all about charity.
I was just reflecting back to this forum, and I've been to quite a few different ICE forums. We actually, at Victorian Health Service, ran one of the first ones 18 months ago, thinking we get about 100 people. 330 people turned up. We literally had to take some of the doors off the hinges so that people could come in. So that sort of gives you a sense of the impact of ICE on the Aboriginal community. We would say that there's not one Aboriginal family that's unaffected by ICE. But I think, as Bill was saying, you can't stereotype the drug. If you can imagine in your own workplace, and I'm assuming most people work in health, that half of your co-workers have a child who's either in the midst of addiction or in recovery. and some of your co-workers are users. So not only, you know, we're a very large organisation, we employ Aboriginal staff, and Aboriginal staff are a microcosm of the broader Aboriginal community. You don't necessarily need to be unemployed to, you know, and have experienced a lot of trauma to be affected by that. So it's a workforce issue for us, as well as a, you know, a challenging issue in terms of how we support our clients and patients. We had one patient recently who hadn't slept for 35 days. It's interesting to hear you talk, reflect on how you didn't think that you slept for about 6 months. One of our biggest issues has been access to the detox facilities in a timely way. You know, we all know there's a long waiting list usually. So I can't tell you how thrilled we were when ReGen made the decision off its own back with no extra government money to prioritise beds for Aboriginal people. And we know that ever since that decision was made, the beds are full. And that's just fantastic. So just the good news that I'll sort of finish up with, as Donna was saying, has just been, you know, the relationship that's developing between staff and ReGen. A lot of Aboriginal people don't want to use mainstream services, and you know, we've got a lot to learn about how we provide follow-up support post-detox and post-rehab. The reason why we're having a specific Aboriginal detox support person, and that's Leonard Harrison, by the way. He's sort of starting in 2 weeks, so we're spending 3 days at ReGen and 2 days at VARS. Part of the reason why it's important to have that sort of role is that most Aboriginal people don't finish detox. In contrast to, you know, the data is a lot higher in terms of the number of Aboriginal people, particularly adults, not so much young people who don't finish detox. So we're just really, really pleased to be learning all the time from ReGen, and ReGen's learning from us. We've, you know, we've been providing cultural awareness training and doing lots of mentoring and support to ReGen. So, you know, we can't do anything on our own. None of us can. So I think, you know, the more we're able to collaborate with services and increase our awareness and understanding about ICE and its effects, and how we can, you know, as Bill was saying, how we can reshape our services so they're not designed, you know, for the interests of staff. And what suits us, they're designed to be able to be responsive as much as possible to the needs of our clients and patients. So thank you, and again, congratulations to ReGen for having this forum.
Thanks very much, Helen. We're not going to go to Nicole again. obviously opportunities to ask Nicole further questions. So this is the over to you stage of the morning. Still morning. Just a couple of rules, or a couple of housekeeping issues. Brandon up the back has got the roving mic, so what we're going to ask you to do is put your hand up if you want to ask a question. Yep. So those that practiced that, you did very well, and I hope everybody noticed that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, though, because the other thing you need to know is that questions apparently are going to pop up from the Twitter sphere. And Paul off the back's going to stick his hand up and he'll be asking those questions as well. The sorts of things, please introduce yourself and your organisation. You absolutely have to be concise in terms of your question and the answers, because we're really keen to get across as many people as we possibly can. Please ask single barrel questions rather than 25 in one. You get first go, and if you've had a go, I'm going to go to someone else, and if we've got the time, we'll come back to you. So they're the rules, but from there on, it's a free-for-all. The panel obviously brings broad experience, and I'm hopeful that we can exploit that, if that's not the right word, clearly, but utilise their experience in by way of questions from the floor. So let's go. One, thank you. Thanks, Brandon.
Hi, Marion Wright from Bowen Health in Geelong. Working with pregnant women, interested from Nicole, it was good to hear the effects on the brain of an adult. Do we have any research, anything coming up about the effect of the developing brain of the fetus?
Look, that's a really good question that I'm probably not going to be able to give a good answer to. There is certainly some research with methamphetamine and a whole range of other drugs that does show that unborn brains are, you know, still developing, and and when they're born as well, that are affected by drugs. But we're not really sure about the extent of that and how that then translates, you know, when they're children or teenagers or adults and the long-term effects of that. But I guess you'd have to guess that anything that's not routine in the womb is going to have some effect at some point.
I think that just one thing you said before, which is helpful within our line of work, is the long withdrawal period. Mm-hmm. So to think about that for the baby when the baby's born.
Definitely.
So that was helpful to start. Anyway, thank you.
Thanks. Down the front.
Stephen King, I'm from the Mental Illness Fellowship in Hepatitis Victoria.
Stephen King from Mental Illness Fellowship in Hepatitis Victoria. My question is, would you be able to expand on the where we're moving with polydrug use and in turn with carers in terms of the support or the new innovations in that area?
I'm not sure I understand precisely the question. Could you...
Yeah, polydrug use and new understandings or new studies or what the new thinking is?
So what about polydrug use?
With methamphetamine, crystal meth and other drugs and its complications and compounding effects?
Yeah, so that's one thing I didn't talk about, that there is a higher than usual among drug users, a higher than usual rate of polydrug use among people who use meth. Did that make any sense?
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
They're bigger polydrug users than other drug users. They'll often... part of that is because of the context that they're using in. So the party situation, they may use a whole range of different party drugs. Or they may be kind of self-regulating. So they may take a bit of meth to stay awake for whatever purpose and then use some cannabis to help them sleep or some benzos to help them sleep. There's, you know, reports of young people who take meth so that they can drink more and for longer. So there's lots of alcohol, meth, overlap. So we do have a group, and I think it is an important point, which I didn't mention, that a group who also, when they go into withdrawal, maybe withdrawing from lots of drugs at the same time, not just one. And we need to kind of treat the whole.
Just to add that the death rate of polydrug use where methamphetamine is there, there's a higher level of death rate overall in the coroner's figures that have been coming out in Victoria.
Yeah, and it makes sense, doesn't it? The more you've got on board, the more likely, the more dangerous it is, and the more likely that you are going to overdose.
The second part of your question, because I'm going to hold it to two. The second part was about carer support, Stephen.
Yeah, the new thinking, or if there is any new thinking in regards to carer support.
If we broaden that out to carer and family support, I think, then, Donna, do you want to comment on that?
Probably just to say that the staff here that work with families are certainly describing high levels of distress in families. So a lot of the support that we're providing through single sessions of brief interventions and counselling and group work that we do in partnership with SHARC is around the family members being able to support the person with the drug use, including methamphetamine use, but also about the health of families in their own right. So there are many families who are suffering with mental health issues in their own right because of the circumstances of living and bringing up children up in families where somebody in the family has drug use, including methamphetamine use. So other than, you know, it's much more addictive and it's much more chaotic and there's some aggression and mood management, I think generally these families are struggling, like all families, with people with drug and alcohol issues.
Sorry, can I read that on part of the panel? Can I speak?
Yes, please. Of course you can.
The other thing is that for people who are in treatment, that is a really important part of the reforms that the government is actually going through presently that does really focus on supporting people, families, loved ones who are actually part of the process.
Thanks, Lawrence. Other questions?
Can I just make a comment?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Anna.
I suppose that's where family support
and drug and alcohol services could work much more closely together. I mean, we have child first, as you probably all know, so it's usually children who are deemed to be at risk who come into the family support system, but often there's a parent or parents with drug and alcohol issues who may be in drug and alcohol services. And we haven't had there's pockets where that's worked well, but it depends on personalities and agencies and how they work together. And I think part of the new recommissioning of the Drug and Alcohol Service was to focus on that, which is what Lawrence is saying. We've got a co-located ReGen worker at Child First who does secondary consultations with staff, and we've also got a co-located child protection worker and a co-located worker from the Victorian Aboriginal Child Care Association. So we're trying to work in a different way about how do we work with families and how do we understand what's happening in families so we support the families, and but we remain very child-centred but family-focused.
Thanks, Helen. Paul, did you want to...
Sure. Sorry. I've got a couple of questions, particularly around the supports for families, like what... What supports families need in their own rights, and how families can be supported to get family members into treatment services and support their ongoing treatment and recovery outcomes.
So Donna's done the first part of that. I'll just say if there's anyone else on the panel that wants to sort of add to those words, then please. Nicole? Yep.
Yeah, I just say that in my clinical experience, one of the features of methamphetamine use and recovery is the really high relapse rate, and one of the things that families often find very difficult is understanding how that could possibly be, and feeling that those feelings of being duped and being, thinking that things are going okay and then suddenly someone relapses, and feeling like they might have been dishonest with them. So from the family's point of view, it's very difficult with this high cycling kind of relapse rate, and it's really essential. And I think that in our culture, probably in our sector, do a very good job of supporting families and educating them. And some of the work that Donna just referred to, I think, absolutely essential to have groups for families, just so that they understand what's going on, because it is hard to watch someone go through that relapse process.
Thanks, Nicole. I'll come back to you, Paul, because I do sense a couple of yep over here. Either way, you choose.
Thanks. I'm Dom Ennis from Youth Drug and Alcohol Advice and YSAS. So I've got a question for Donna. I think I saw in some of the pre-reading or the reading in the packs a suggestion that there might have been higher retention rates for young people using meth at your youth-specific unit. And then when Nicole was talking about some of the, I guess, the suggested strategies that, to me, being coming from a youth-specific treatment background, they very matched very closely with some of the evidence-based characteristics of effective youth provision, so flexibility of appointments and assertive follow-up, behavioural strategies and community reinforcement rather than just sort of talk-based stuff. So I'm wondering whether some of your youth-specific programs have been a good source of what's worked for some of the more adult the adult-specific programs.
Yeah, that's exactly our experience when we did the file audit and we looked at clients that had been through ReGen over a period of time. We found the outcomes for youth withdrawal were much better, and the duration of stay and engaging in treatment were much better. And then when we went back and reflected and talked to staff about the differences and why that was, exactly those things you talked about. You know, youth services are used to being very flexible. Our youth service is 5 beds and it has the same staff ratio as we have for 12 beds for adults. With youth, you've got duration of drug use has been less, and often families still are around in some, giving some level of support. So we lent heavily on learning from our youth service about how we could incorporate some of those things in both to the non-resi model but also to the adult model, whilst acknowledging that in the adult withdrawal unit, they're working with 12 clients who've been using for much longer periods of time, so much more mental health issues, family breakdown, that sort of thing.
Kevin Myers from Nexus Dual Diagnosis Service. Just wanted to look at the issue of both emergency departments and inpatient mental health services, both of which have got enormous pressures for a very rapid turnaround. Emergency departments often are in a situation where they're managing the behavioural issues and then the person is actually leaving and not getting support, or they're being transferred to mental health. But in average bed stays now, it's around 11 days. And Nicole's research is obviously showing that that's actually not going to be enough to either stabilise the situation or offer support. So I'm just wondering whether people think we could be doing something to target those sort of pressure points, really.
Start with this. Some of this stuff's already been done in New South Wales. It's not rocket science. You basically build your system around your client's needs. These clients have drug problems rather than hip fractures or whatever. And then you need to set up some system to step them down into something else, take into account the particular problems of the three-day timeout, the psychosis, whatever they're presenting with at the time. But it needs to be an integrated system, and that needs to be argued for in Victoria as much as anywhere else. And I really don't think it's rocket science. It's problematic for the authorities in an acute point in time with a particular individual. The coppers have problems, the ambos have problems, and the hospitals have problems, and so do we in some sense. They need to grapple with it on an equal basis like we're grappling with it, and it's solvable.
Just add to that, I think it's interesting with methamphetamine, and you would have heard listening to Nicole, we're starting to learn more about withdrawal. So in the past, if someone had spent 11 days in a psych unit or 4 days or 5 days in a medical bed somewhere, drug and alcohol service would have said they don't need withdrawal. We put them in counselling or something. So what we're starting to learn is with this really prolonged withdrawal period, that there might be great benefit for a person even after 11 days of coming into a withdrawal unit and experiencing the benefits of sleep and nutrition and the group programs and the post-withdrawal planning and some of that sort of stuff. So that's another thing we have to really think about.
Thanks, Donna. Natasha?
Natasha Colwyn, drug and alcohol clinician, Wodumba Willem Region. A lot of the focus today has been on the withdrawal, the sort of more immediate withdrawal from ICE. And given what Nicole was saying about the sort of long-term effects up to 18 months afterwards, I was wondering if we've got any scope for longer-term sort of recovery rehab programs, something maybe along the lines of Catalyst or Tour, or if that's been looked into.
Yeah, so for people who don't know, Catalyst is a six-week non-residential program for people who use alcohol as their primary drug. But we've just recently been funded to look at that model and adapt it for people who use a range of drugs who are involved with the criminal justice system. So we're only into about our second or third group, and it's being externally evaluated. But we expect that there will be a high number of people who are using methamphetamine that come into that program. And one of the things obviously we'll need to think about really carefully is when they come. So clearly there's a period of withdrawal that might go on for some time, but when their cognitive function is such that they can benefit from what is quite a quite intensive program.
Could I also?
Yes, you can.
It's not really an answer to your question, Natasha, but there's only a little bit of research around this, but meth users tend not to do that well in residential, long-term residential treatment. Their outcomes are not particularly good. They're not as good as for other drug users, and they relapse much sooner. And I think Rebecca McKeaton did some work and showed that after 3 years, or I can't remember, it was as if they'd had no treatment at all. So I think we need to really think very carefully about who, not just say, oh, well, you know, this person has a long-term problem, that it's going to be a long-term recovery, so therefore that equals residential care. I think we need to think a little bit carefully about using outpatient counselling, about using day programs, and about using residential care more flexibly, again, and thinking about who goes into where based on how they're presenting.
Thank you. And Helen, thank you.
There's a tender process out at the moment for an Aboriginal Youth Rehabilitation Service, and who knows who's going to get that, but I can say that VARC is putting in partnership with WISAS, so that service is Bunjawara, and we're based, and will be in Hastings. I think it's like
the it's up to a six-month stay. So it's interesting what you're saying in terms of some of the evidence based around there. But I think that is important to make it up. And can I just also point out the question came from one of the Wadamba Willem team. There's four people here at the back. Can you put your hand up? Just so people know you. This is a
You've been outed.
Oh, you're all here. Oh,
right.
This is a brand new service, new team. It's going to be launched, I think, in about 6-7 weeks, called Wadamba Willem, which is basically a service to support Aboriginal people with mental health issues and drug and alcohol issues, because we know they often go together, who are at risk of homelessness or are homeless. So there's a position based at ReGen, position based at NEMA, position based at VARS. Have I missed one?
Mental Health Man.
And the Northern Area Mental Health Service. So it's been fantastic. We've been able to pick up lots of people who fall through the gaps, whether they're, you know, identified at you know, the psych unit or in a detox bed who basically have nowhere to live or are at risk of homelessness. So that's a new team, and you know, we're down the world, look them up, and hopefully they might come to the launch as well. Thank you.
I like a bit of spooking. Paul, are you ready to, or I'll leave you to think.
Sorry, we've got a couple of other questions have come through about workforce capacity, and I guess that's been raised in the opening remarks already. So I guess across your various sectors, what workforce capacity issues do you see, and what can be done about it in terms of building individual sectors' capacity to respond to methamphetamine and to promote more collaborative practice?
Well, as you know, the government's got this 10-year document. They've got a 3-year implementation plan. We haven't been able to speak to them about detail because of the probity issues, and that'll go on as long as this reform process goes on. Then I think it's going to start opening up. And there's a range of initiatives which we've started to get wind of. But workforce capacity is really everything in this sector. It's about maintaining the pointy end as well as the generalist end, allowing the people to find it a welcoming place to walk into, culturally appropriate. You know, it doesn't happen overnight. These are all workforce issues, and it really is, I think, the cutting edge of a cutting edge system.
Thanks, Sam. I just want to let you know we're into the last 5 minutes, so this is where it can get very interesting and people can scramble to get a question in. I encourage you to do that. There's one across here. But I think there was one. Sorry, I'll do the order in a different way because I know you did put up your hand a little earlier. So, yep. Thank you. I can't read your...
I work at the Summit. I am working with young people, yep. Lower diners and the homeless sector. And I'm working in the Western region. My question is, I worked UK 16 years, and where I found the cocaine and a few more common than amphetamine. My question is, we have initiated a recovery college, and Bill's presentation I found, he was saying about his partner, knowledge is power, and information to the carers and friends and families, how to impart that knowledge, structured, systematic way to the families and carers. We don't have any initiative, kind of concrete steps to have that information imparting to the carers, friends and families, knowledge, and is there any initiative which is started or policy on that? That's my question.
So initiatives in relation to family of people, yeah, who are...
Recovery and, yeah, how to that getting that,
yep,
knowledge to the families.
Thank you. Gee, I don't know, so that's where I flick across to the panel.
I might just say something about the single session work.
Yeah.
Look, there's a lot of support ideas of how to support families, so including them in programs and certainly with Talk and Catalyst, we have family groups within the program itself, and we've got the partnership with Sharp where we do the 6-week education program. But probably one of the things we found most useful recently is we've introduced single session work. So it's based on the Bouverie single session model for working with clients and adapted for families by Bouverie. We run a separate calendar. So any family member or client that rings up with a family member, we can say straight away, do you want a family session, a single family session, which we can get to happening within a couple of days. We've trained all our clinicians in this model, and so we can run a separate calendar. And what we find is probably about 70% of the families that come in and do a single session say that's actually all they needed. So it's education, inclusion, a bit of treatment planning, what to expect, that's all they need. For the other 30-35%, then they want to go on and have more, like the ART program or counselling. But for a lot of families, that single session, brief intervention, is actually what they need to get started, and that's been really successful for us.
Thank you. Two more questions, and I know there was one over here, and then there was one here, and then we're going to stop.
I might just mention, because I've got the mic, we also have Meth PEP program for people, and that's open to the community in general and provides a sort of a three-hour program on methamphetamines and some of the information that families may want.
Thanks, sir. My name's Michael Miller. I'm from Family Drug Support, and I just have a question to yourselves there. I'm coming across a lot of families, and I've actually spoken to some of their children that are preferring to go into jail for their detox because they know that they get overwhelmed in a rehab facility or in a detox environment. They're scared of their own outbursts during this time and that they can walk out onto the street at any time they like. Are you experiencing this, and do you have any comments in regards to, instead of people having to go to jail, how we can service them a lot better?
I've certainly heard people say that, and I've heard families say that particularly, that that's an outcome they would see desirable. Equally, we have people come to us who have got legal things and are trying to get programs and treatment happening so they don't go to jail. So, you know, I think it works both ways. And it's a pity if people are thinking they need to go to jail, because I think we all know that treatment's not necessarily that great in jail. And there are other risks around, you know, bloodborne viruses and things that happen in jail. So, yeah.
I think that's expressing the frustration around failures of system capacity, and jail's not the solution. We should all actually resist that. 70% of people go into jail and use drugs illicitly. Jail does not solve the problem. Many of them are repeat, you know, they're frequent flyers and go back for more because of the failures. And the treatment regime in the prison system isn't optimal.
Nicole?
Well, I was going to say something very similar to Sam. I think that what we need to listen to is the message that's coming through, which is the treatment system's not adequate to deal with the needs, and we need to rethink how we provide that treatment in that case, rather than saying, well, jail is the same place, even if it's not going to be a good option.
Thanks, Nicole. Helen?
I'll just add to that, and also add a comment that a lot of people have been institutionalised. Different parts of their life, whether they've been removed from family, removed from the country, incarcerated, you know, in a juvenile detention centre. So what we find is a lot of our clients who have had that history certainly feel more comfortable and feel they get a lot more support. And I think the challenge too is to change the mindset of people who work in health too, because I think there is a little bit of a, I think some of that is sometimes can be reinforced. And that's terrible. So, you know, it's good to be to actually acknowledge that that is an issue, and I thank you for raising it.
Thanks, Helen. And Amy is the last questioner. Thanks, Amy.
My name's Amy. I'm a final year nursing student at La Trobe University. With regards to general drug and alcohol, but specifically methamphetamines, with the younger generation developing drug problems, are you looking at more technology-based treatment and therapy options in regards to drug and alcohol? Are you looking at app development or more friendly websites to really kind of make that care applicable in the home?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Do you want to do that?
That's occurring here at ReGen is making it much more accessible. Now, there's international researchers that they had here at the last session. What was his name? Adam Linstock. It's that gauges what's being used and how it's being used on an international basis. Then to reflect back into our systems and how we can adapt our systems. There's a lot more than needs to be done.
There's also just from a research perspective, sorry to keep talking about research, but there's been a lot of work in the last probably 10 years, in fact now, the time is flying very quickly, that shows that online and app style, you know, electronic type of therapy is just about as effective as face-to-face counselling, even by a really highly trained psychologist, which is a bit disappointing.
You've got a development.
Yeah, that's right. That's a job for you. But it does mean that it opens up a lot of options for a lot of people, not just young people, because I'm old, but I know how to use a computer. So even for, you know, people into their 30s and 40s and 50s who might not want the stigma, and there is absolutely still stigma in having drug treatment, they can access a lot of this stuff online. And the other point that I wanted to make was that in Queensland, at the Centre for Youth something, Alcohol and Drug Crisis, at Queensland University and QUT, they have a joint centre. They're doing a lot of work developing up apps and online treatments and a whole range of things with David Kavanagh, who is a leader in the field of electronic stuff. So a lot of their stuff is just starting to come out now. And I think that is really, I think it's fantastic because it just really opens up another avenue for people to access treatment.
Thanks, Nicole.
Can I the human touch myself.
Thanks very much. Can I do two things here in one go? It's thanking Ray, but suggesting if you've got any interest in technology and things like, you know, what are the opportunities for online treatment, online advice, online. Ray, who's done, I think, after a, was it a shaky start, or in IT terms, was that okay?
Fine. Yeah, it wasn't so fine.
The rest of the world didn't. So we thank Ray for his efforts today, but certainly he would be someone to chat to about some of the developments in that area as well. Thanks, Amy. That's it for us. There's never enough time, and we apologise for that. If you've got time to hang around, you may find that some of the speakers on the panel will have a moment as they're walking towards the door to answer a question. Could you join with me in thanking with them, and then I'm going to hand back over to thank you. And I'll hand back straight over to Sandy. Thank you.
Well, just up to me to make some closing remarks. So thanks everyone coming today. It's been a wonderful
session. Paul's told me you can sign up for updates on training, consumer participation, and events. I think it's at the entry table. Yep. Now I just need to make some thank yous to wrap things up. Firstly, I want to thank our speakers and our panelists. Of course, Nicole, Rose. She's there. Thank you, Rose. Think Mal, of course, who can forget the shirt? Bill, and thank you so much, Bill. If I can pass it on, Kamal, please. And to our panelists, of course, Helen and Eileen and Sam and Donna, and thanks, Trevor, as well, for your facilitation. Some thank yous also to ReGen staff who've worked really tirelessly to help make today happen so well and so smoothly. Lisa, Paul, Brandon, excellent work with the mic, Brandon. Jane T and Jane JR. Rita, Adrian, Louise, Scott, and Ray. Thanks so much, Ray. And, of course, all the other ReGen staff who also supported their colleagues with all the work being done for today. So I think that's about a wrap, is it, Lawrence? He's giving me the thumbs up. So thanks, everyone, so much for coming. We look forward to doing it again next year. Oh, evaluation form. Don't forget the evaluation. Yes, evaluation forms, please. In the folder.